be seated. And so, friends, we hear from the psalmist this morning as we are gathered in worship. The heavens declare the glory of God, the skies proclaim the work of his hands. Day after day they pour forth speech, night after night they display knowledge. There is no speech or language where their voice is not heard. Their voice goes out to all the earth, their words to the end of the world. In the heavens he has pitched a tent for the sun, which is like a bridegroom coming forth from his pavilion, like a champion rejoicing to run his course. It rises at one end of the heavens and makes its circuit to the other. Nothing is hidden from its heat. The law of the Lord is perfect, reviving the soul. The statutes of the law are trustworthy, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, giving joy to the heart. The commandments of the Lord are radiant, giving light to the eyes. The fear of the Lord is pure, enduring forever. The ordinances of the Lord are sure and altogether righteous. They are more precious than gold. They are sweeter than honey from the comb. By them is your servant warned. In keeping them, there is great reward. Who can discern their errors? Forgive my hidden faults. Keep your servant also from willful sins. May they not rule over me. Then will I be blameless, innocent of great transgression. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. And glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. We remain seated as we sing. Responding to the words, Lord, have mercy, with the words, Lord, have mercy, and the words, Christ, have mercy, with the words, Christ, have mercy. In Jesus Christ, the Holy One is bringing justice to the oppressed and food to the hungry. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
In Jesus, the Holy One is setting the prisoners free and opening the eyes of the blind. Christ have mercy. In Jesus, the Holy One is lifting up those who are vulnerable and bowed down. Lord, have mercy. Holy One, we confess we do not listen to Jesus. We want the gospel to be good news for us alone. We do not want to get our hands dirty with the poor, the oppressed, the prisoners. Forgive us for being insulated and isolated. In your grace and mercy, open our eyes, for we are often the blind. Breathe new life into us, for we are often the apathetic. And release us, for we are often the ones bound by our sin. Through your Holy Spirit, may our hearts be challenged, minds convinced, and wills conquered. In the name of Jesus Christ, the Lord. Amen. And we remain seated as we sing, "Change My Heart, O God." May we who are sometimes swayed by the crowd's approval and who often avoid conflict for the fear of its cost to us, hold fast to his gospel of peace and justice, and follow faithfully in the way of compassion and solidarity with those who are poor and excluded, wherever that journey may lead us. Thank you, Maggie. Seated. I'm going to invite Margie to come forward, who's going to bring us our reading from the Old Testament this morning, from the book of Nehemiah.
They told Ezra, the scribe, to bring out the book Ezra the priest brought the law before the assembly, which was made up of men and women and all who were able to understand. He read it aloud from daybreak till noon as he faced the square before the water gate in the presence of the men, women, and others who could understand. And all the people listened attentively to the book of the law. Ezra opened the book. All the people could see him because he was standing above them. And as he opened it, the people all stood up. Ezra praised the Lord, the great God, and all the people lifted their hands and responded, "Amen, Amen." Then they bowed down and worshipped the Lord with their faces to the ground. They read from the book of the law of God, making it clear and giving the meaning so that the people could understand what was being read. Then Nehemiah, the governor, Ezra the priest and scribe, and the Levites who were instructing the people, said to them all, "This day is sacred to the Lord your God. Do not mourn or weep." For all the people had been weeping as they listened to the words of the Lord. Nehemiah said, "Go and enjoy choice food and sweet drinks, and send some up to those who have nothing prepared. This day is sacred to our Lord. Do not grieve, for the joy of the Lord is your strength." Amen.
Gathered together in the square, young and old, men and women, certain and seeking, slave and free, gathered together in the square, they opened and read the book. They listened and talked and prayed. They opened the book, gathered together in the square, and they heard the word of God. Let us now stand as we open the gospel and hear the word of our Lord. And today our gospel comes to us from the gospel according to St. Luke. And I begin reading at chapter 4. And we're invited to hear these words from verses 14 to 21. Jesus returned to Galilee in the power of the Spirit, and news about him spread through the whole countryside. He taught in their synagogues, and everyone praised him. He went to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and on the Sabbath day he went into the synagogue, as was his custom. And he stood up to read. The scroll of the prophet Isaiah was handed to him. Unrolling it, he found the place where it is written, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to preach good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to release the oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." Then he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendants, and sat down. The eyes of everyone in the synagogue were fastened on him, and he said to them, "Today, this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing." Friends, this is the word of our Lord. Thanks be to God. Shall we be seated? And let us pray. Dear Lord, help me to expect miracles. Help me to get past the borders of my eyes, the roadblocks of my mind, the narrow door of my heart. May my soul embrace the mystery of your magnificent love. May my heart rejoice, and may my heart be filled to overflowing with joy over the unexpected. May my mind and body sigh with the sheer awe of who you are. Amen. And we remain seated as we sing. Open our eyes, Lord. Our reading from the Old Testament is somewhat of a hard act to follow. An 8-hour sermon that had everyone weeping before the Lord. I will not try to follow in Ezra's footsteps, literally, but I want to invite us today to consider the power of that moment. The power of a moment where men and women and children who can understand hear the word of God and it does something within them. And I wonder how often we attend to the scriptures with a sense that we are looking only for words of encouragement, words that make us feel happy, and okay? Do we allow the scriptures to confront us like a mirror, to show us not only what needs to change within us, but also who we can become? There's a story of a missionary who was working somewhere in North Africa. It was a true story, and one of the stories he recounts in his early days of the mission is how he encountered a woman who used to come to church literally with the Bible on her head. And he asked her, you know, what is so special about this book? And she said to him, all the other books I read, but this is the book that reads me. And I think that that is, for me, a helpful way of approaching the scriptures. This is the book that reads us. And as we encounter the scriptures, we are sometimes moved to recognize what we are not proud of in our lives, what we discover to be destructive in our lives, but also we are moved to discover who God calls us to be, and more than that, who God empowers us to be. Unlike a motivational book or a self-help guide, the Bible simply tells us a story of who God is, and a story of who we can be. And we are invited to find our place in that story. Stories are important because we all live within a story we tell ourselves. A story we tell ourselves about the world, a story that we tell ourselves about who we are. We are storytelling people. That's how we make meaning and sense of our lives. We tell a story. And we're invited, as we read the scriptures, to find our story in the bigger story of a God who continues to come to us and continues to move us towards a life that is more abundant and free than the life that we could possibly create for ourselves. Some time ago, I read a novel called A Thousand Years of Solitude. It's quite a long read, but well worth reading. And basically, it tells the story of a fictional town in South American Colombia. It's a story with a lot of Spanish names that I can't really pronounce properly, so I'm not going to try and do that. But it's an interesting story, and one of the moments that sort of stood out to me in the story was the moment when a plague came to this town. It was an illness that caused insomnia. You literally didn't sleep. Maybe we experienced some of that last night, but it caused insomnia. The problem was that insomnia eventually led to memory loss, and so people were scared of this plague. However, the inhabitants of Macondo initially welcomed the insomnia as positive because they had more time to enjoy. They could perform the necessary tasks that they needed to. However, they soon completed all their tasks and they began to feel depressed because they no longer had dreams on account of the insomnia. When forgetfulness eventually began to affect their daily lives, one of the characters in the story invents a way to remember the names of objects by writing their names on the objects, by putting labels on everything. But eventually, the information on the labels needed more descriptions as the people began to forget even more. And so an example is, this is the cow. She must be milked every morning, so she will produce milk. And the milk must be boiled in order to be mixed with coffee to make coffee and milk. And so the town labeled everything and described everything until the point came when they could no longer read the letters. The writer says, thus they went on living in the reality that was slipping away, momentarily captured by words, but which would escape irredeemably when they forgot the value of the written letters. And I want us to maybe consider that this fictional story tells us a little bit about who we are as a people. As a people, we are those who often find their meaning in their activity. We are a people that tend to be over-concerned about what we are achieving and what we are doing, and we come to think that our doings define our being. We are also a people who often lack imagination. We tend to believe that the way that life is now is the way that it is always going to be. And possibly worse still, we believe that the way life is now is the way things should be. We're also a people who forget. We're a people who easily forget what has brought us to where we are. We're a people who easily forget that life is fragile. We tend to live as if tomorrow is certain. And we're a people who forget that everything we have can be lost in a moment. And because we're a people who forget, because we are a people who do not imagine, and because we are a people who believe that life depends entirely on what we do or do not do, we tend to be a people who lack gratitude. Because we believe that everything is self-generated, we've done it for itself, there is no room to acknowledge that what we have and who we are is a work of grace. The theologian Walter Brueggemann describes our condition like this: having been so greatly blessed by God, we tend to forget those times when we were not so blessed, and the present benefits of faith appear to us to be self-generated. We've done it ourselves, and there is no one to thank, therefore no one to whom we are accountable. Weak praise and poor thankfulness lead to weak living and poor ethics. Our scripture readings today invite us into an imaginative reality, a reality that, far from being simply imagination in the form of wishful thinking, is the kind of imagination that creates what it dreams. As Jesus stands up in the synagogue and speaks of the blind seeing, the lame walking, and the prisoners set free, and as Jesus stands up and says, "Today, these things are fulfilled in your hearing," Jesus invites us to imagine. He invites us to imagine because today there are those who believe that their disabilities, their seeming imperfections, define who they are. Today there are those who are imprisoned by their addiction. And possibly all of us might fit into that category. We're addicted to so many things that give us a false sense of being okay, but at the same time are stripping things away. Today, we do not see beyond our own prejudices and biases, our own place in the world. And so we're invited to imagine. We're invited to imagine that there is another reality, more powerful and more true than the one that we are living in. And these words of Jesus invite us to the bold and courageous attitude of hope. Hope, on one hand, is an absurdity. And it's almost a little bit of wishful thinking. For it flies in the face of all those claims we have been told are facts. Hope is the refusal to accept the reading of reality which is on the surface. And to do that is a bit risky. Hope is a little bit subversive, for it limits the grandiose pretension of the present, daring to announce that the present, to which we have all made commitments, is now called into question. Hope is the decision to which God invited Israel, a decision against despair, against resignation, against just simply getting through the day. It's a decision against depression, barrenness, and feeling disconnected. There's the lovely story of a man who once dared God to speak. "Burn the bush like you did for Moses, God, and I will follow. Collapse the walls like you did for Joshua, God, and I will fight. Still the waves like you did on Galilee, and I will listen." And so the man sat by a bush near a wall close to the sea and waited for God to speak. And God heard the man, and so God answered. He sent a fire, not for a bush, but for a people. He brought down a wall, not of brick, but of sin. And he stilled a storm, not of the sea, but of the soul. And And God waited for the man to respond, and he waited, and he waited, and he waited. But because the man was looking at bushes and not hearts, bricks and not lives, seas and not souls, he decided that God had done nothing. Finally, he looked to God and asked, "Have you lost your power?" And God looked at him and said, "Have you lost your hearing?" Jesus is asking those who hear him to open their eyes to see the burning bush, to become more attentive to God's promise to abide with God's people, here and now. God, no matter what we may believe or come to believe, God is not undone by our lack of belief. God is forever moving forward to a life more free and full. This call forward is a call that we are invited to hear. It is a call to see more deeply, past the immediate sin, injustice, trial, and evil of human life. And those are realities. But to also see the profound love, compassion, and grace upon which everything rests. The love of God and neighbor. If we can see, experience, and grasp that active force of love that is always at work in our world, our fear recedes, our hearts melt, and our willingness to seek revenge flows away like a tide. And we can recognize in the midst of all things, even in the worst of circumstances, God is with us. Through our delusions of domination, the clarity of grace, mercy, and justice make themselves known to us. And that transforms fear into compassion, giving us the power to walk in the way of love as God intended. Living in God's promise is about now. Today, the scripture is fulfilled in your hearing. When the Word became flesh and lived amongst us, the Word did not form a committee, establish a strategic planning session, gather together an indaba, debate all of the circumstances in which people were living. The Word did not form a political party, write a manifesto, enlist people in the cause, and guilt and shame them if they did not join in. Instead, the Word became flesh and lived amongst us. And we are invited to hear that Word and to allow that Word to transform our lives. We're a people who forget. We are people who forget that beyond what we see, feel, and touch is the reality of a grace at work, setting hearts free, changing lives, and changed lives change the world. But because we are a people who forget, we don't allow the Word to change us. We need a community to tell us, again and again, that beyond what we see is another reality. Beyond what we see is another possibility, and it is God's. And so, friends, here is the word of the Lord. Here is bread and wine. Take these and eat them, for in this bread and wine is hidden the grace of God. Amen.
Amen.
And so I'm going to just share with us a prayer poem by Walter Brueggemann, who I've quoted. On our own, we conclude there is not enough to go around. We are going to run short of money, of love, of grades, of publications, of romance, of beer, of members, of years, of life. We should seize the day, sees our goods, sees our neighbor's goods, because there is not enough to go around. And in the midst of our perceived deficit, you come. You come giving bread in the wilderness. You come giving children at the 11th hour. You come giving homes to exiles. You come giving futures to the shut down. You come giving joy to the dead. You come fleshed in Jesus. And while we, the blind, receive their sight, while we, the lame, walk, while we, the lepers, are cleansed, while we, the deaf, hear, while we, the dead, are raised, while we, the poor, dance and sing, we watch. And we take food we did not grow, and life we did not invent, and future that is a gift, and a gift, and a gift. And families and neighbors who sustain us when we did not deserve it. It dawns on us, late rather than soon, that you give food in due season. You open your hand and satisfy the desire of every living thing. By your giving, break our cycles of imagined scarcity, override our presumed deficits, quiet our anxieties of lack, transform our perceptions to see the abundance, mercy upon mercy, blessing upon blessing. Sink your generosity deep into our hearts, that your muchness may expose our false lack, that endlessly receiving we may endlessly give, so that the world may be made new, without greedy lack, but only wonder, without coercion, but only love, without destructive greed, only praise, without aggression and invasiveness, all things new, all around us, towards us and by us, all things new. Finish your creation in wonder, love, and praise. And so I'm going to invite us, as we respond, to sing together, "There's a River of Life Flowing Out for Me," and then Mark is going to lead us in intercession.
Approach your throne humbly and with faith and hope that you will hear our Wynberg prayer. We pray for the poor and the poor in spirit. Give your people the vision and tools to minister to them. We pray for the imprisoned, whether incarcerated in jail or by their own selves, through addiction, sin, loss of will or lack of will, disease of mind, body and soul. Break the chains that bind them and set them free, merciful God. We pray for the lonely and mourning. May they be presence in their lives. We pray for our congregants around us and next to us. Refresh their spirits in this new year. We pray for our country amid the noise and the haste and the hate and foolishness. Bring wisdom, love, light, and hope, please, Lord. We thank you for Graham, his faithfulness, his energy, his love, and his light he shows always. Bless him with your everlasting spirit of love. Give him the energy and health needed in the year ahead. We pray this in and through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
And so, friends, we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. And so, friends, I'm going to invite you to stand for a moment and to take a look at one another. We get to speak God's peace into one another's hearts, and so as we come to this table, may the peace of our Lord be always with you. Shall we look at one another and share the words of peace? And if you did not get a red communion book, now would be the time to grab a red communion book. So, let us prepare to come to the table as we celebrate who we are. For I'm building a people of power, and I'm making a people of praise. grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forevermore. Amen.